Hey, welcome to the long-awaited, highly requested Marks and Chill episode 8. Today we talk about human requirements and division of labor under the rule of private property and under socialism, division of labor in bourgeois society. And before we dive deep, I want to remind you of two things real quick. First of all, you guys voted to have this video up next on my channel, so if you like to take part of those kind of polls and I don't know, any kind of like input into my channel, make sure you subscribe or you follow me on Twitter. But also I want to remind you guys to please get vaccinated for COVID. I just had my second shot and thank God it wasn't that bad at all. There are so many reports that people are not getting either their second shot against COVID or not getting vaccinated at all. Marx would have definitely gotten a COVID vaccine, I'll tell you that much. Also, today we have little Phoebe in the back keeping us company. But anyways, let's get started. So if you guys remember the last reading, we had spoken about how in an ideal society, your senses would be so fulfilled, your sense of smell, sight, taste, touch. We would be enjoying life, basically. And so we're gonna talk about how the opposite happens under capitalism and how money becomes the new need for everybody. So we have seen what significance under socialism the richness of human needs becomes. Under private property, the richness is reversed. Every person gambles on creating a new need in another, as to sacrifice them to make them dependent, and seduce them into a new form of enjoyment, therefore economic ruin. Each person tries to establish an alien power over another, to find satisfaction in their own selfish need. The increase in the quantity of objects is therefore accompanied by the alien powers to which a person is subjected. Every new product represents a potentiality of mutual swindling and mutual plundering. Humans become poorer, their need for money becomes even greater if they want to master this hostile power. The power of their money declines in inverse proportion to the increase in the volume of production. Their neediness grows as their power of money increases. Therefore, the need for money is the true and only need produced by capitalism. The quantity of money it produces is its sole effective quality. Excess and indulgence come to be its true norm. Now, this appears partly in the fact that the extension of products and needs becomes subservient to inhuman, sophisticated, unnatural, and imaginary appetites. Private property does not know how to change crude need into human need. It's idealism, it's fantasy. The producer puts themselves at the service of the most depraved fancies, plays the pimp between themselves and their needs, all so they can demand cash for their service. Every product is bait to seduce away the other person's being, their money. Every real and possible need is a weakness. This estrangement manifests itself in that the sophistication of needs and the means of their satisfaction on one side produces a barbaric, complete, crude, abstract simplicity of need. Even the need for fresh air ceases to be a need for the worker. The human returns to a cave dwelling, which is contaminated with the diseased breath of civilization, a place which they occupy, yet from which they can be thrown away at any time if they do not pay. Light, air, basic animal cleanliness ceases to be a need for humans. Filth and this stagnation of humans, sewage, comes to be the element of life for them. Deprivation becomes their life element. The Irishman knows no need but the need to eat. The savage and the animal have at least the need to hunt, to roam, the need for companionship. The simplification of labor is used to make a worker out of the immature human who is still a child. The machine accommodates itself to the weakness of the human being in order to make the weak human being into a machine. When I read that thing about the fresh air, you don't need fresh air, maybe. It honestly made me think of like how many hours do I spend in my apartment, and sometimes I don't even open a window, and it's true. I don't even like remember that it's probably like really stuffy in here, you know what I mean? Anyway, that's gross. But you know what I mean. The multiplication of needs and their satisfaction breeds the absence of needs. And it is demonstrated in the capitalist by two things. Number one, by reducing the workers' need to the barest and most miserable level of physical subsistence, and by reducing the workers' activity to the most basic mechanical movements. Humans have no other need either of activity or of enjoyment. And second, by counting the most meager form of life as the standard, the capitalist changes the worker into someone with no needs, and all of their activity into pure abstraction from activity. To them, every luxury of the worker seems reprehensible, and everything that goes beyond the most abstract need, whether it's passive enjoyment or activity, seems to be a luxury. That reminds me of like when I've had like the most demanding bosses, like those bosses that are paranoid that you're not working every goddamn second that you're in the office kind of thing. Capitalism, therefore, is a science of renunciation, want, of saving, and it actually reaches the need where it spares humans of the need for either fresh air or physical exercise. This science of marvelous industry is simultaneously the science of asceticism, and its true ideal is the wealth hoarder and the productive slave. Its moral ideal is the worker who takes a part of their wages to the savings bank. Thus, capitalism is the most moral science of all. The renunciation of the self and of life and of all human needs is its principal thesis. The less you eat, drink, and buy books, the less you go to the theater to dance, the less you think, love, theorize, paint, sing, fence, the more you save, the greater becomes your treasure, which neither moths nor rust will devour your capital. The less you are, the less you express your own life, the more you have, the greater is your alienated life, the greater is the store of your estranged being. Everything which the capitalist takes from you in life and humanity, they replace for you in money and wealth, and all of the things which you can't do, your money can do. It can eat and drink and go to the dance hall and the theater, it can travel and it can acquire art, learning, the treasures of the past, political power. All of this it can appropriate for you. Yet, being all of this, it wants to do nothing but create itself by itself, for everything else is after all its servant. And when I have the master, I have the servant, and do not need his servant. All passions and activity must therefore be submerged in greed. The worker may only have enough for them to want to live, and may only want to live in order to have that. On the one side, Lauderdale, Malthus, etc., they recommend luxury and they hate thrift. The other side, Say and Ricardo, recommend thrift and hate luxury. But the former admits that it wants luxury in order to produce labor, absolute thrift. And the latter admits that it recommends thrift in order to produce wealth, luxury. The Lauderdale-Malthus school has a romantic notion that avarice alone must not determine the consumption of the rich, and it contradicts its own laws in advancing extravagance as a direct means of enrichment. The other side proves that I do not increase but reduce my possessions by being extravagant. The Say Ricardo school is hypocritical in not admitting that it is precisely whim and caprice which determine production. Meaning, like, if you guys go back to like a few of our readings, we were talking about how everybody's basically free to start their own business, right? But we like don't really determine if we actually need those type of businesses. So yeah, it's basically just whim, which is directing production and jobs, etc., etc. The Say Ricardo school forgets the refined needs. It forgets that there would be no production without consumption. It forgets that as a result of competition, production can only become more extensive and luxurious. It forgets that a thing's value is determined by its use, and that use is determined by fashion. It wishes to see only useful things produced, but it forgets that production is too many useful things, produces too large a useless population. Both sides forget that extravagance and thrift, luxury and privation, wealth and poverty are equal. I think meaning that at the extreme of wealth, that person is just as poor in spirit, because it can never have enough. And you must spare yourself of gratification, sharing of general interest, all sympathy, all trust. You do not want to be ruined by illusions. You must make everything that is yours sellable. That is useful. First of all, this is right here where we're all getting called out, because like so many of us are trying to, I mean, for obviously good reasons, we're all trying to figure out our own business or how to make our side hustle somehow profitable or make that our full-time. And it's like, to one extent, of course, there's a practical side to that, and you know, there aren't enough jobs, so of course we want to do that. And you want to do something that makes you happy. But on the other side of that, it's like we are all making everything that we have sellable, especially through things like social media, how much we share, how many things we share, because they will make us go viral, or I don't know, it will just add to your persona online, or you know, whatever, all kinds of iterations of just selling yourself and all parts of yourself. So anyway, however, if you sell your body, although you are following capitalist laws, you of course are transgressing ethics and religion. The ethics of capitalism are acquisition, work, thrift, sobriety, but it promises to satisfy my needs. The capitalism of ethics is good conscience and virtue, but how can I live virtuously if I do not live? And how can I have a good conscience if I don't know anything? It comes from the very nature of estrangement that every sphere applies to me a different and opposite yardstick. For each is a specific estrangement of a human being and focuses attention on a particular field of estranged essential activity, each estranged in relation to the other. Thus, M. Michel Chevalier reproaches Ricardo with having ignored ethics. But Ricardo is allowing capitalism to speak its own language, and if it doesn't speak ethically, it's not Ricardo's fault. The relationship of capitalism to ethics is an arbitrary, unfounded, and unscientific relationship. Capitalism expresses moral laws in its own way. Frugality as the principle of capitalism is best shown in its theory of population. There are way too many people. The existence of human beings is a pure luxury, and the worker is ethical if they only produce sparingly. The meaning which production has in relation to the rich is revealed in the meaning which it has for the poor. The worker's crude need is far greater than the refined need of the rich. The cellar dwellings in London bring more to those who let them in than do the palaces. They bring the landlord greater wealth, greater social wealth. Industry gambles on the refinement and crudeness of needs, whose true enjoyment is unconsciousness. This illusory satisfaction of need is contained within the barbarism of need. English gin shops are symbolical representations of private property. Their true luxury reveals the true relation of industrial luxury and wealth to humans. Capitalism has no ethics other than to hoard money, create money, don't spend your money, and work. That's pretty much it, which is pretty sad. We have already seen how the capitalist establishes the unity of labor and capital in a variety of ways. Number one, capital is accumulated labor. Number two, the purpose of capital within production is productive labor. Number three, the worker is a capital. Four, wages belong to the cost of capital. Five, in relation to the worker, labor is the reproduction of their life capital. Six, in relation to the capitalist, labor is an aspect of their capital's activity. In 7, the capitalist presents the original unity of capital and labor as the unity of the capitalist and the worker. This is the original state of paradise. The way in which these two aspects confront each other is for capitalism an accidental event, which can only be explained by external factors. The nations which are still dazzled by the sensuous glitter of precious metals are still fetish worshippers of metal money and not yet fully developed money nations. Equally as the basis of communism is its political justification. If we characterize communism itself as the negation of private property, one might be satisfied by in it in their consciousness only by the real transcendence of their thought, since the real estrangement in life remains with them and remains the more one is conscious of it. Hence, the negation of this estrangement can only be accomplished by bringing communism. What I took that to understand is like, you will only be able to transcend estrangement when we bring communism into true form and not just thinking about it and wishing or, you know, theorizing about it. Now, it takes actual communist action to abolish actual private property. History will lead to it, and the movement, which in theory we know to be a self-transcending movement, will constitute in actual fact a very rough and protracted process. When communist artisans associate with one another, theory, propaganda, etc., that's their first end. But at the same time, as a result of this association, they acquire a new need, the need for society. Human company and conversation is enough for them, and their nobility shines from that community. When capitalism claims that the demand and supply balance each other, it forgets that according to its own claim of theory of population, the supply of people will always exceed demand, which is why through this disparity of demand and supply, human existence is what suffers. So capitalism claims that demand and supply will eventually balance each other out, yet while at the same time claiming that the population will always exceed the demand, which is why it's always the population that is suffering, because we will never reach that balance of demand and supply. There will always be more demand from the population because the population is ever growing. The extent to which money constitutes true power is seen clearly from the fact that landed property is acknowledged as true political power in life. In the Middle Ages, a social estate is emancipated as soon as it is allowed to carry the sword, and among nomadic peoples, it is the horse which makes somebody free and a participant in the life of the community. We have said previously that humans are regressing to the cave dwelling, but in an estranged, malignant form, because their cave or dwelling is not their home. It is somebody else's home, and if they don't pay the rent, a stranger will throw them out. Furthermore, the person is also aware of the contrast in quality between their dwelling and someone else's who has more wealth. Now, estrangement manifests not only in the fact that my means of life belong to someone else, but in also the fact that everything is different from itself. My activity is something else, and all of that is under the sway of inhuman power. There is a form of extravagant wealth given entirely to pleasure, the enjoyer of which frantically spends with no purpose, but also sees the slave labor of others as the prey of their greed. With such wealth, contempt shows up as arrogance and as squandering, a which can give sustenance to 100 human lives, and partly as the illusion of non-stop, unproductive consumption, which is the condition of other people's labor and therefore their subsistence. That person sees the essential powers of humans only through excess, whims, and capricious notions. This wealth, as not yet experienced true wealth, is an alien power over itself. It sees in it only its own power and enjoyment as its final aim. And I'm sure while I was reading that, all of you guys can think of like whatever rich person comes to your mind and how much they spend non-stop to the point where they have more than they could ever need. Because at one point you have so much that you couldn't possibly enjoy it all. Like, I have a tiny ass closet and I haven't even worn everything that I own. So I just find it really interesting that even back in the 1800s, late 1800s, this was already a thing. Like, the mega rich back then was already mindlessly consuming. It's not like necessarily that it just became a thing today. It's probably been normalized now, but it already existed back in the days. The illusion of the nature of wealth is confronted by the working, sober, economic industrialist who provides in a way in which others can indulge in their products and this way appropriates for themselves the other person's diminishing power, meaning their money. It is therefore industrial wealth, which appears to be the result of extravagant wealth, but it is industrial wealth which in itself ends wealth. For the rate of interest falls as a consequence and result of industrial development. And so the extravagant person's wealth diminishes day by day, in inverse proportion to the increasing possibilities and pitfalls of pleasure. As a consequence, they must consume their capital and ruin themselves, or become an industrial capitalist. Since rent of land also rises as a result of industrial development, similarly, the squandering landlord must eventually consume their capital or become the farmer of their own estate. And which makes sense why rich freaking people feel like they can't stop working and like it's never enough, because their mindless consuming is constantly threatening their wealth. And instead of diminishing their spending because they already have enough, they just need to work more so that they can have more, even though they already have everything. The lowering of the interest on money is only a symptom of the power of working capital over squandering wealth. The transformation of all private property into industrial capital, it is a complete victory of private property and the subjection of the owner of private property to labor. Now, the industrial capitalist also takes their pleasures. However, their pleasure is only a recreation, calculated and economical pleasure. The money they squander must not be more than they can replace through profit in whichever form they create money. Pleasure is therefore absorbed under capital, and the pleasure taken individual under the capital accumulating individual. And of course, on the most practical level, this makes sense. All of us workers can only enjoy our pleasures to the degree in which we don't want to ruin our lives, because we don't want to waste all of our money because we need it to survive. So even our pleasure is being absorbed by capitalism. It's to my own detriment if I don't curtail my interests, my pleasure, my hobbies, etc., etc. The argument between luxury and thrift is therefore the only fight between capitalism which has achieved a clarity about the nature of wealth, and that capitalism which is still afflicted with romantic, anti-industrialist memories. An argument between delusions and clarity. Capitalism is forcing you to be thrifty at all times. Even the mega rich are forced to, in their own sense, be thrifty, meaning they just gotta work more to make more money. Moreover, rent of land has been overthrown since modern capitalism has proven that the landlord is the only completely unproductive renter. And at the same time, the position that tax on land is the only tax on unproductive income, which additionally resulted in landowners no longer benefiting from political privilege that they once had. Everything Proud Hun sees as the movement of labor against capital is only the movement of labor in the determination of industrial capital. Only when labor is grasped as the essence of private property can the economic process as such be truly analyzed. Society to the capitalist is a civil society in which a person is the totality of needs for the other person and only exists for the other person as the other exists for them. They reduce everything and everyone to either a capitalist or a worker. The division of labor is the economic expression of the social character of labor within the estrangement. The division of labor is nothing else but estranged, alienated human activity, position as real activity of the species. And of course, division of labor had to be seen as a major driving force in the production of wealth as soon as labor was recognized as the essence of private property. As for the essence of division of labor, political economists are vague and contradict themselves about it. Adam Smith says, "This division of labor does not originate from any human wisdom. It is the necessary, slow, and gradual consequence of bartering and exchanging one thing for another, which is the consequence of reason and speech. It is common to humans, and it is not found in any other race of animals. Animals are entirely independent, while humans always have a need to help one another. One is more likely to prevail if we can appeal to the other person's interest and show them that it is to their advantage to do what the other person needs them to do for them. For example, in a tribe of hunters, one person makes bows and arrows with much more dexterity than the others, so that person frequently exchanges them for cattle or other supplies with their companions, and they find eventually that in this way they can get more cattle than if they themselves went out to hunt them. Based on their own self-interest, making bows and arrows then becomes their main business. The difference in talents between people is the effect of division of labor, not the cost. Without the need to trade and exchange, the person will have to produce everything they need in life. Everyone will have to do the same work, and there would be no difference in employment that could give way to different talents. And it is the same need which forms the different talents, which renders that different, to be useful. The different tribes of animal, however, are not of use to one another, and neither can they use their strengths for the convenience of one another, and each animal is still obligated to support and defend themselves separately and independently. While among humans, even the most different of people are of use to one another, the respective disposition to barter, exchange, etc. produces their talents, and then they become like a common stock anyone can purchase when they need. It is the power of exchanging that gives occasion to the division of labor, so that division of labor must always be limited by the extent of the market. And when the market is very small, no person can have any encouragement to dedicate themselves entirely to one employment. Thus, in an advanced society, every person lives by exchanging, and to some extent becomes a merchant, and the society itself becomes a commercial society. However, Adam Smith also states that if every family produced all that it consumed, society could keep going without any exchange of any sort taking place. The division of labor is a skillful deployment of people's powers, and it increases society's production, its power, and its pleasures, but it reduces the ability of every person taken individually. Production cannot take place without change. Now, once again, we go through like a few philosophers' opinions which are contradictory, as Marx just stated. Thus, said, the powers inherent in humans are intelligence and their physical capacity for work. Those which arise from the condition of society consist of the capacity to divide labor and to distribute different jobs among different people, and the power to exchange mutual services and the products which constitute these means. The motive which compels one to give their services to another is self-interest, and they require a reward for their services rendered. Exchange and division of labor reciprocally condition one another. Now, Starbuck says, Mill presents developed change, trade, as a consequence of the division of labor. In employment of labor, it is often found that production can be increased by skillful distribution, and separating all operations which have any tendency to impede one another, and by bringing together all operations which can aid one another. In most cases, it is necessary to operate at large scales, which gives existence to great factories, which can supply multiple countries. Thus, Mill himself said, Modern capitalism agrees that division of labor and wealth production, division of labor and accumulation of capital, mutually determine one another. Just as it agrees, the private property can produce the most useful division of labor. Examining labor and exchange is of interest, because they are perceptibly alienating expressions of human activity, and essential powers as species activity and power. To assert that division of labor and exchange rest on private property is nothing but to assert that labor is the essence of private property. Division of labor and exchange are the two phenomena which political economists use to boast the social character of their science. Yet, they give unconscious expression to its contradiction, the motivation of society by unsocial particular interests. The factors we have to consider are, first, the propensity to exchange, the basis which is found in egoism, is regarded as the cause or reciprocal effect of the division of labor. Say regards exchange as not fundamental to the nature of society. Wealth is explained by division of labor and exchange. Starbuck divides human powers of production into two. Those which are individual and inherent to them, their intelligence and their disposition or capacity for work, and secondly, those derived from society, division of labor and exchange. Furthermore, the division of labor is limited by the market. Human labor is simple mechanical motion. The fewest possible operations must be apportioned to any individual, splitting up of labor and concentration of capital, the insignificance of individual production and the production of wealth in large quantities, the meaning of free private property within the division of labor. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, I felt called out hard multiple times throughout this reading. Let me know in the comments which part of the reading affected you the most. I felt called out the most when it was saying, like I told you guys, when it was like, oh, human beings lose the need for fresh air. I'm like, shit, when did I last open my windows? When did I last leave my apartment? Just like walk down the block. But yeah, I do agree that under capitalism, it is like we're constantly having to sell parts of yourself, get other people interested in buying parts of yourself which are for sale. Hashtag subscribe to my channel, I guess. And like sacrifice our own pleasures or satisfy our pleasures and sacrifice our own stability as human beings, our ability to eat, live, you know, have shelter. And I thought it was interesting that even rich people kind of fall into that. Like, of course they have a lot more wealth, then at that level they're trying to fulfill so many pleasures with endless consumerist behavior that inevitably they end up losing their money. So it's a constant battle for them as well to keep making more money so they can keep satisfying the pleasures which are out of control, because we're all dealing with our estranged feelings in one way or another. But yeah, that's all I have for you today. Thank you so much for watching. If you still are, subscribe if you like to continue talking about world domination, and I will see you in the next one.